So glad that you can join us today, City Gate, as we continue in our sermon series, Prophet, Priests, and Kings. As Pastor Gray announced earlier, Pastor Dave and Miss Michelle will be back next week. Next Sunday, they'll be back. And so I know they miss all of us. They miss me for sure. I know they miss me. But they definitely miss all of us. And so I'm so glad that they got to get so much good rest. And I'm definitely missing them. So happy that they'll be back. But we're closing out the sermon series of Prophet, Priest, and Kings today. It's the final sermon of that series. And I had the privilege, Pastor, like, go ahead and finish this thing out. And I had the privilege of teaching this today. And I was praying and like, God, you know, what would you have me say? What would you have me teach on? And he very clearly told me that he wanted me to speak on how all of the prophets, priests, kings, laws, and psalms, they point and speak of Jesus. How they all point and speak of Jesus. So today we're going to be diving into Luke chapter 24, like verse 44 through 49, just kind of through those five verses and kind of bouncing around a little bit to highlight some things that that I believe God wants us to see in that. But before we dive into it, let's pray and let God do what he came to do. Heavenly Father God, we thank you, Lord. Lord, you spoke to me that this would be a message that exalts Jesus, that helps us understand the deepness, the glory of our Savior and the Messiah. So, Lord, I pray that you would anoint each and every word that I speak today. Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would bring revelation to your people, that they would receive a word directly to their hearts that applies to their current situation and the way they're living their life. Father, we need you, for we are nothing without you. Use us as you will. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks so much, Reed. Appreciate it, brother. So as we're going through this thing and just finishing out the Prophet, Priests, and Kings, one of the most important and probably blessed times that I've had with the Lord in Scripture was getting the understanding that the God of the Old Testament is still the God of the New Testament. Sometimes in the Old Testament, we read a lot more about laws and commandments and ceremonies, and it seems like a different God than the God of the New Testament, which is of mercy and love and all of these things. And I think that's partly because some of those things in the Old Testament are somewhat hidden. They're kind of somewhat an afterthought, where we see God being so forgiving and calling the people to repent. And what I want to share with you today is that the God of the Old Testament, he's still the God of the New Testament. He's the same God forever and forevermore. But also that the New Testament is the revelation of the Old Testament. The New Testament is revealing some of the hidden secrets, some of the hidden treasures of what's in the Old Testament. God is telling the story of the Old Testament of creation, but he's also speaking to things that we may not have known at the time, but he's speaking of what is to come, and he's speaking of his son. So I want to help you understand today that the entirety of the creation plan, God never needed a plan B. He never needed to remix or remake his plan. He never used whiteout in his creation plan. Amen. He never used spell check or delete. You know, he had a plan, and his plan was good from the beginning. His plan was good from the beginning. And so even when Adam and Eve fell, he was good with the plan. Even when Jesus took the cross and it seemed like he was defeated, he was good with the plan. Even when he had to clear the earth with a flood, he was good with the plan. He never needed a remake. He never needed a remix. He was always good. And then you ask yourself the question, well, how can God be good with the plan if he knew creation would fall? How can he be good with that plan? And God has given me wisdom as a father. You know, parents say amen. You know, if you got that wisdom, you've earned it, parents. But as a parent, I began to think, if God revealed to me before my child's birth that all of the problems my child would cause, all of the hurts and pains and falls, and he gave me the opportunity for them to not be born, I'd choose it anyways. I'd choose that they would still be my child, because I believe with my parenting, me and my wife, and through the power of God, that we can help our children navigate those falls. And so in the same way, God says, I see the fall, I see the sin, I see the wreckage, but I am that good of a God. I'm so good that even in their terrible life, I'm going to restore them to wholeness. I'm that good. Even when I have to clear it out and start over again with just a remnant, I'm that good of a God. So he sees the fall and he says, no, I'm not changing anything. I'm steady with a plan. And that plan is pointing to my son. It always has, and it always will. For my son was with me in creation, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and he's with me in the end, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There's nothing new. There's a note I want you to take down today, and that it's God has always been a triune God. He's always been in three parts. He's always been a God that works this way, from the Father, through the Son, by the Spirit. He's always worked from the Father, through the Son, by the Spirit. And we see it through the Old to the New Testament, and God is a faithful God, and he continues to work in that way. God did not all of a sudden need a mediator. He chose for the Holy Spirit to be the power and the force. He did not all of a sudden need to have a Savior. He chose from the beginning that the Son would be the Messiah. Why is this so important, Matt? Because I believe that we need to know that God is a consistent God and he has not failed. He has not gotten nervous. He has not wavered, but he's consistent and he's faithful. If we jump into the New Testament and start reading some of the Gospels there, it's so good. All of those letters about the church, it's very rich text. It's very applicable to our life as a Christian. But what I want to present to you is if you're just reading the New and you're not seeing the connection to the old, as we see today that Jesus has called us to, then you're coming into the game in the third quarter. You're turning on the football game, and the score is 14-21, and your team has no timeouts left, and your star player's not there, and you're wondering, how did we get to this situation, but you're looking and hoping for victory. That's what it's like when you jump into the New Testament, and you're moving forward. You see that there's victory on the way, but how did we get to this place? And so God in the Old Testament is really setting up the beginning of this thing. He's the beginning of the game. So get with me, Luke 24, verse 44. We're going to read through this thing, and then we're going to break it down verse by verse and just really see what God has for us today. So in this moment, Jesus has taken the cross. He's died. He's resurrected. He's back. He showed up on the disciples. He scared them like, whoa, what's going on? That's Jesus. Thomas had his moment where he felt him, and now Jesus is about to lay down some wisdom on him. And so this is where we pick up right here. Verse 44, it says, then he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, this is written that Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead. And the repentance for this forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. So Jesus begins this message saying, everything written in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms were speaking of me. They have to be fulfilled through my life. See, these things were actually directing you and pointing you towards me. And so we talk about the law of Moses. That's not just the commandments. Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, right? So in Jewish heritage, this was everything for them, right? So he wrote the Pentateuch. And so he's talking about that first five books that Moses wrote. And I want to highlight something to you in creation, in the creation story, that God spoke, but was much more about his son than it was about what we often think it is. And so right here, we're going to pick it up in Genesis 3:14. God is actually sending the curse out to the serpent. And he says, so the Lord said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all the cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head and shall bruise, he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Speaking of Jesus, pointing to Jesus. How do we know that, Pastor Matt? We see this right here when it says, and between you, your seed, and her seed. He says, between your seed and her seed. All throughout Scripture, seed is always spoken of from the man. Abraham's seed, Isaac's seed, Adam's seed. This is the only plot in Scripture where the seed comes from the woman. It's pointing to the immaculate conception. That this woman would only have a seed because God has given her the seed. That she has a seed in a miracle fashion because this father of this child will be the heavenly father. He's pointing and saying, her seed. And then we can tell it further because from that he says, and he, not they, not them, not the church, but he, one, singular, shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. How does the enemy bruise the heel of Jesus? Through the crucifixion. On earth, it seemed like he wasn't the Messiah. For so many, it seemed like he was a false prophet. Look what happened to him. So many said, if he was the Son of God, then he should get himself off of the cross. So many had said that. So it seemed like it was the end, but really, through Scripture, it was just the bruising of a heel. It really just kind of messed up the limp just a little bit. But it says that the seed would bruise his head, the central of the body. And how he did that was through the resurrection. Because it seemed as if he would die, but he resurrected and now became the atonement for sin. And now created a path for all of mankind to come unto the Father. See, God was using this moment where he's speaking to the enemy, but he's also speaking of the future. And what he's doing right here is he's showing us that his plan has not changed. Actually, in the moment where it seems like everything goes awry, actually in the moment where he has to send these Adam and Eve out of the garden, he's saying, no, actually my plan is in place. Actually, I'm speaking to you about the curse of the enemy, but I'm also speaking to you about the healing of the world. My son, who is to come. And so I often ask myself when I'm writing this sermon, it's like, what is this? Why is this so important, Matt? Why does this really matter so much to people? And so I thought of this example of an anniversary surprise party. And so you have a married couple, married for 15 years, and so the husband sets up a surprise party for the wife for the anniversary. They get to the restaurant, and then surprise, everybody jumps out, right? They're so happy, it's so awesome, and so the wife's just surprised. She loves it, and she begins to go through the party and talk to her friends. She sees her parents, and her parents say, yeah, we bought these tickets 6 months ago. We were flying out. She begins to see her friend from college and say, yeah, you know, we actually knew that we were going to come to see you over a year and a half ago, right? And then the wife's going through. She's just kind of like, wow. She runs into the manager of the restaurant and says, thank you so much. And he said, yeah, your husband reserved this 3 years ago. And she begins to see that the party's still the party, but the intentionality behind the planning of the party makes it so much more meaningful. And so God, he still sent his son. His son is his son. But the intentionality behind the Savior, thousands of years prior, speaking of him way before we existed, shows that he cares in the little things. He cares so much. Why does it matter that he cares so much? Because when we understand how deep and how good our God is, then we begin to understand how great the covering is in our life. When God is only this big, we feel like we only have this much of a covering. But if God is an eternal God that spoke of a Savior thousands of years before we existed, and thousands of years he will be sustained, then we understand the covering over us is much bigger than the entirety of our existence. He's our great God. And it's hard to come up with new words to explain it because you just begin to ramble. I don't know about you, and I just, you're just so good and just amazing and just love. You know, you just can't. But he's just good. He's just good. And so even to the point of when he sees creation and the fall of man and all of this craziness, and he sees himself in the picture, he says, man, that creation looks good. because he's in it. He's like, that looks good. Because he's that good of a God who's intentional, planned, and seen before and covered us with a son. His intentionality is beyond anything we can know. It should continue to blow our minds how intentional he is, how precise he is, how loving he is. It should continue to blow our minds. So we're going to keep walking through Luke 24. So we're going to get back to verse 45 now. We're walking through there. And so Jesus then says, then he opened their minds to understand the scripture. Okay, this is really good. And so what did he do to open their minds? He began to connect them from the Old Testament to himself. He began to say that the law of the prophets, the law of Moses, the prophets and the Psalms point to me. And this begins to open up their understanding of the scripture. So it's one thing to understand that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and he is the atonement for our sin. And through him, we get to know the Father. That's a great thing, and that is true. But it's a much bigger thing to understand that the promise made to Abraham that he would be the father of a nation that outnumbers the stars in the sky and the sand of the seashores is fulfilled in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Because there's no way that Abraham can have a nation that he fathers just purely through the nation of Israel. But once Jesus took the cross and he opened up the inheritance and he adopted in the Gentiles, and now every man who called on his name would be made grafted into the tree, now this nation begins to form. And now this nation begins to unfold. You're talking about a 1,000-year-old promise that comes to fruition in a Savior that also gives mankind new hope in the Creator. It's a much bigger thing. Why does it matter that it's a much bigger thing? Because it helps you to understand the covering of our Father. It's much bigger. It's much greater. It's much more powerful. And it's super intentional. God cares, and he cares about you. So some of the things, I was like, sometimes you think, like, does God care about the little things in life? He surely does. He cares about the little things you go into. And when you begin to know this and truly believe this, the intimacy feels different, right? I don't know if you ever prayed about like a headache? Like just something like, Lord, take this headache away, right? You know, like, you believe he can, or just about your sore feet or your sore back or just something that's just kind of just small. But the only way you can do that is when you truly believe that God cares about the little things. Because how can he care about the big things and the little things? Because he could talk to the enemy and also talk to the future at the same time. He's a God that can do both in one. So he can talk, he can pray, he could be sending a message and sending deliverance for the orphans as he's also healing your footache. He's that kind of God. He's that kind of God. He's a great God who cares about the little steps, who cares about the little things. Keep rolling on to verse 46. And he said to them, this is written, that Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead. So he's talking about how he must suffer and he must rise from the dead. Earlier in scripture, in the book of Matthew, Jesus begins to actually talk about this a little bit more clearer. And so what's happening is there's some religious leaders there, and they're like, you know, they're like challenging Jesus, like, man, if you're really the Messiah, then we got to see a sign. Show us a sign. We want to see a sign. And Jesus is like getting at the heart. He's like, they don't want to see a sign. They're not going to believe in me anyways. So I'm going to actually just speak to them. And he speaks to them, this verse right here in Matthew 12:40. It says, for just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Christ is taking this moment to point to the Old Testament. He's saying Jonah, who we all learned in Sunday school, Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days. You thought that was just random. You thought that was just because God, okay, I'm tired. Like, we can get Jonah off timeout now. No, right? No. He said, I'm going to do this for 3 days because my son is going to be in the belly of the earth for 3 days. He said, I'm pointing to Jesus. He said, I'm pointing to my son. I'm showing them a type. I'm showing them an experience that's going to reflect the precision and the intimacy that I have for my son. And the story about Jonah is very significant when you look at the story of Christ, because Jonah was going to Nineveh to do what? To call them to repent, because they had been messing up. And Jonah, so God said, you go and you tell them either they repent or they feel my wrath. And Jonah didn't want to go, as we know, but Jonah actually began to talk to God while he was there, and he was disgusted because he was saying, God, you're gonna not let them feel your wrath. I know you. He said, I'm going to begin to say this, and then you are not going to go through with it, because he knew the character of God. He said, God, I know you're such a good God. He's upset because God is so good. He's like, you're going to make me look like a liar. He says, because I know how good you are. And he said, go. And so he goes and he calls them to repent, and then they repent, and God doesn't pour his wrath out on the people. In the same way, God sent Christ that there would be a way through repentance, that there would be a way where they wouldn't have to receive the wrath of God, but that Jesus would take it on himself. That Jonah was a type of Christ, foreshadowing Christ, but he could not fully be Christ. Only Christ is that. Only the Messiah is the Christ. He cares about these things. He cares that we connect it all, that we put it all together. Verse 47, as we're moving down in Luke 24, it says, and the repentance for the forgiveness of sin shall be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. It says, you are witnesses of these things. Right here, we see that he is beginning to talk about the forgiveness of sin. He's talking about what it means to be forgiven and what it looks like to be forgiven. But earlier in John, we see that Jesus begins to point to Old Testament scripture of what it looks like to be forgiven. John 3:14, he's using the story of Moses, and it says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in me will have eternal life. This was always one of my favorite parts in scripture, because I never judged the nation of Israel in the wilderness. I don't know about you, but I'm just not a camping, backpacking type of a person, and they were struggling out there. It was hard. No food and no place to stay, and it was tough. And so they begin to complain. They're complaining, like, why didn't we just stay in slavery and all of these things? They're beginning to complain. And so God said, I'm tired of this. Y'all not going to make it to the promised land anyways. I'm just going to send some of these snakes on y'all. And these snakes go out and get them, and it poisons them. And they begin to be sick. And now, of course, they begin to cry out, Lord, where are you? And so they begin to pray, ask God. And Moses goes and prays. And God says, yeah, I'll care for you. What I want you to do is I want you to make a bronze snake. I want you to lift it up, and once they repent and they look onto the snake, then I will heal them, right? And so that's what he does. They do that, and the people are healed. And so in the same way, Jesus is saying, in the same way that that bronze serpent was lifted up, is the same way that the Son of Man must be lifted up. That I must be lifted up. You must hold me in high regard. You must ask for repentance, and the healing would take place. The same way that they were sick from the poisonous snake, the same way that you are sick in your sin, once you are look upon the Son of Man and I am lifted up, the healing will be there. He's saying, look at a type of me. Look at what it looks like in the Old Testament version, pointing and speaking of me. God is so good that he takes the time to care about your little needs and the small things you walk through, because he wants you to have a covering that you understand that he's with you every step of the way. And sometimes we lose that. Sometimes we forget that. But when you begin to connect the dots and see that he's the God of the Old Testament and the New Testament, then you have a faith that says, I believe I can go another day. He's a God that holds steady and is faithful and is true. I remember when I began to understand that God cared about the small things in my life. It changed just how I lived. It changed how I prayed specifically. And it made me realize how great of a God he is. Because I don't know about you, I often tell people, oh, yeah, remind me to do that. Because I often forget the medium things in my life. But God can remember the small things. And I said it in first service, and I won't be able to share this story too many years from now, so I have to use it now. But when we were having kids, I did not want a daughter. I did not want a daughter. And it's because I've met some crazy women in my life. None of you in here, of course not. But I've met some crazy women. And I'm just like, Lord, I cannot. No, do not. Please, Lord, do not. And my wife will attest, I was praying for twin boys, two and done, two and through, Lord. Knock it out. Two and through. And he was like, nope, I'm not messing with you. And so I had one son, and I'm like, ooh, okay, here we go. We got one more. We always wanted two kids. I'm like, ooh, okay. And then so we're kind of getting ready for this, and my wife is pregnant, and I'm sleeping, and I have a dream where I have a girl sitting on my lap, on my knee. I'm at like a party with some friends. And I'm like, okay, yeah, whose kid is this on my knee? You know, I'm like, I don't know who baby I got right here. But I can tell she's a girl. You know, she got curly hair. And then the girl turns and looks at me. And as soon as she looked at me, I could tell she's my daughter. Like, she looks like me. And it just hits me, you know, into my heart. And then in that moment, my heart's changed. Now I feel totally different. It's not even a feeling. It's an acceptance. I can accept it. Yeah, it may be a burden, but my heart's changed about the burden now. And I wake up, I tell my wife, I said, babe, I think we're having a girl. I said, I think I had a dream, had a girl too. A couple weeks later, we're having a girl. Now I got baby Gigi here. 2 years from now, you won't hear that story anymore. But I'm just telling you, I can't let her carry it over my head. But what I'm telling you is, God did not have to do that. He didn't have to give me that dream. I could have just walked through the hardship of being a daughter of a wild young girl, and his grace is enough. His grace is sufficient. The church is enough. But he cared about the small thing that I would have peace to know it's going to be all right. Actually, I'm not going to answer your prayer. I'm going to grow you through knowing that I'm faithful, right? He said, I'm not going to answer the prayer you want it. I'm going to answer the prayer the way I know you should have it. Here's your daughter. Here's your peace. Now go. That's how good of a God we serve. And as I spoke last week, sometimes he tells us wait, or 2 weeks ago, it's not because he doesn't want to give us what we need or what we want. It's because he knows what's better for us, and he's preparing us on the path. How does he know these things? How is he this great of a God? He's been doing this since creation. He's looked at the earth. He's looked at man. He's looked at the fall and said, I'm with God in the equation, it's so good. It's so good. Matt doesn't want daughters, but with me in the mix, it's going to be amazing, right? You're not ready to do what you think you're not ready to do, but with God in the mix, it's powerful. This is the God we serve. This is the mighty God who says that we need to walk with him. The worship team can come on up as I close this thing out. Verse 49, the last verse in this section of passage, it says, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. This is showing us again that God has always worked as a triune God. He's from the Father, through the Son, by the Spirit. He said, my Father promised that he would send the power. Wait, because the Holy Spirit coming. The day of Pentecost is about to happen, and the Holy Spirit is about to fall. All through this sermon series, we talked about great men of God. We talked about Elisha. Pastor David talked about how Elisha was all in and how he would not allow Elijah to ascend without him having his eyes on him. And he said, if you don't let me slip away from your sight, I'm going to give you a double portion. And so Elijah receives the double portion and all of these amazing things. Elisha was great. But Jesus was greater. He said, this was a man of God, but I am God in flesh. No one is more all in than me. No one keeps his eyes on God more than me. Elisha was great, but I am the Messiah. We talked about David, how David is a man of low stature. He's a shepherd in the field, and he is known for he is the man after God's heart. Well, Jesus was more after God's heart than David ever was. He was a low stature. He never got to be the king. He was always a servant, and he was only come to be about his Father's business. David is great, and Jesus comes in the lineage of David, but Jesus is greater than them. All throughout Old Testament, we see Solomon, as Pastor David shared, he had the privilege of building the temple. He had the privilege of building the temple of God. This was an amazing privilege. And he was dependent on God to be the wisest man ever told in history. But Jesus was greater than he. For he depended on God for every step that he made. As Pastor Fernando shared with me a couple weeks ago, Jesus would get fatigued with compassion, healing and helping, and just burned out. And he would immediately go into the wilderness 40 days, 40 nights. Drench me, Lord, once again. Fill me once again, Father. These men were great, but none greater than me. For all of them fell short, but Jesus came to fulfill. He is the one talked about through the prophets, the priests, the kings, and the law. Our God is so big, so deep, and so wide that it covers the eternal existence of your life from beginning to end. You never have to question. You never have to wonder, is he here? Does he know? Is he calling me? Is he speaking? He always is, because he's never left. My hope today in prayer is that Jesus would be exalted. Is that as we grow in understanding of who Jesus is, our faith would grow, our prayer would grow, our worship would grow, that we would begin to praise him in a way that we never have before, not just today, but with the rest of our lives. Is that we would truly be able to say that Jesus is enough, that Christ in Christ alone, that we would really understand what Paul means when he says, I know Jesus and Jesus Christ crucified. That's all he knew. That's all I know. And it doesn't just mean him on the cross. It means I understand the promise of Abraham. I understand what he did with Noah. I understand what he did with Joshua. I understand what he did leading up to the cross. And now I understand what he's doing in the church. All I need is Christ and him crucified. And that's more than enough to live three times over. Jesus said, when you connect these dots, when you understand that God of the Old Testament is speaking of the Savior to come, that your mind is open to Scripture, and you begin to understand the text that it says in Revelation, the testimonies that will help you overcome the enemy. Let me pray for you this morning. Father God, we praise your name. Lord, you told me to share this word in a way that exalts you. Told me that in this place today, the name of Jesus should be lifted up. You told me that the Messiah is the one spoken about all throughout Scripture. Father, we love you so much that we say, have your way. We love you so much that I pray that you would continue to water and bring to fruition what you've started in the hearts of these people. Lord, I pray that in this place, in this time, that they would begin to say Jesus. They would begin to say Messiah. They begin to say the Christ. They begin to say Yeshua. And they would say that God is so much bigger. My Savior is so much greater than I often give him understanding for. But Lord, this understanding will carry them through the highs and lows of life and walk them through this coming days and weeks and months and years. Father, speak to your people. Reveal to them what you have for them. In Jesus' name, amen. The worship team's going to worship. I want you to just have a moment of reflecting on how good God is. If you feel led to sing, if you feel led to stand, go ahead and do your thing. But let's just worship.
All the Father saw in the days of old, would you do it? Would you do it again? All the stories told, all the miracles, would you do it again? Would you do it again? 'Cause you said, consecrate yourselves to me, and you will see amazing things, 'cause we need your revival. kings and kingdoms falling, hear your people calling, King of kings, we need a miracle.
I don't want to leave this place without giving us a true opportunity to worship those words. Those are powerful words. The Savior is for us, and His glory surrounds us. We're calling for revival in this place. I said that I believe that God has called us to just really exalt Christ in this place today. That it wouldn't just be here and now, but it'd be the words that we walk on throughout the week. It'd be that Jesus is more than enough, that the Savior is for us, and that revival is breaking out wherever He would send us. So the worship team is going to lead us again, and let your heart pour out through your worship as you exalt Christ this morning. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, God. We praise you, Jesus. You are more than worthy.
And the King is among us.
Yes.
And His glory surrounds us.
We praise you, God.
And His fire. The Savior is for us, and His love is victorious, and revival is rising in His name. And the King is among us, and His glory surrounds us, and His fire is falling as we sing. And the Savior is for me, His love is victorious, and revival is rising in His name. 'Cause we need your revival, Holy Spirit fire, burning ever brighter in our souls. And kings and kingdoms falling, hear your people calling. Of kings, we need a miracle, and the King is among us, and His glory surrounds us, and His fire is falling as we sing. And the Savior is for us, and His love is victorious. And revival is rising in His name.
Lift your hands with me this morning as we pray. We lift our hands in surrender to the Father. Heavenly Father, you see your children, clay vessels of treasure, because you've deposited your Holy Spirit. Father, we submit ourselves to you, saying that you are way more than enough. That your plan for creation still sustains in us today. And we don't desire just to walk another day on this earth, but we desire to be used by you according to your will. Father, you've created this church that your people would go forth and share the goodness of God. We didn't come just to be a churchgoer, Father. We came to be filled up to go about this next week. I pray that today we would be filled up enough that we would walk on this word, that Christ is more than enough, that Jesus was intentional from the beginning to the end for our lives, that we'd carry it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and if we begin to be weary, we have the hope of gathering with the church once again. For you've called us to be the extension of your body, that we are all intricate parts, glorifying the Father. Let the word of us needing a Savior resonate on our lips. Holy Spirit reminding us that the connection of the old to the new opens our mind to Scripture. And as we dive into your word this week, that you would put Scripture on the tips of our tongues, that we'd be able to encourage those all around us with the word of God. Not with our own worldly wisdom, but the wisdom that goes beyond the time to the Ancient of Days. Lord, we love you. We submit to you. And we are nothing without you. We praise you, Jesus. for you are a Savior. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Give the Lord a praise, amen.